planet Earth has existed for over 4 billion years. But it is only in the last 10,000 years that the human being has come to dominate the globe. But the progress of mankind has not always been smooth. Golden ages have often been followed by long periods of decline. In the first millennium AD, this is what happened in the lands of Western Europe. From the 4th century onwards, the influences of the classical world declined. In what is now England, the departure of the Romans led to 700 years of invasions and conflicts. The terrible attacks of the pagan Vikings have come to symbolize the period now known as the Dark Ages. But the light of civilization was never fully extinguished. Christianity survived. One of the finest biblical texts ever created was made in Dark Age England. It was a time that saw the rule of famous leaders like King Alfred. A time when great monuments were constructed. By exploring the ancient chronicles and the discoveries of archaeologists, we can reveal the true story of Dark Age England.
The Dark Ages was invented as a term to describe the relative lack of knowledge that historians had about life after the Romans left Britain until really the Norman conquest. But I don't think many people think it's a very helpful term today, because it suggests that everybody who was alive in that period was stupid and didn't know anything. Archaeologists have shown that in terms of buildings, in terms of objects, people had a very rich and diverse and interesting culture. So it wasn't Dark Ages at all. We know a lot about that period.
In some people's minds, it refers simply to the period that happens as the Romans leave Britain. There's a couple of hundred years where the settlers come from the Germanic kingdoms, and Britain is in fact in a state of turmoil, and you know, the sort of re-establishment of settlements, and the Britons are driven back. And that is what classically is referred to as the Dark Ages. But beyond that, you get the beginnings of Anglo-Saxon society as we know it, which of course culminates in some extraordinary art, the Lindisfarne Gospels, for example, extraordinary material. And this is not the Dark Ages. The kingdoms are being established, you get a settled community. Of course, the Anglo-Saxons are then threatened by the Vikings, and they disrupt the tenor of, the even tenor, if you like, of Anglo-Saxon life. And so it is, in fact, a continual surging, if you like, almost a sea-like movement of disruption, civilization, settled patterns of life. And then more disruption. It's an extraordinary period.
In the year 400 AD, the Roman fortification of Hadrian's Wall lay abandoned. A symbol of the decline of the empire. By 409 AD, the last of the legions had left the province of Britannia that lay to the south. Soon, the Romanized Britons they left behind were under attack by raiding tribes of Picts and Scots. In desperation, the Britons appealed for outside help to save their Christian way of life. With hindsight, we can see this as the beginning of Dark Age England. The Britons summoned the aid of foreigners to help them see off the raiders. They were mercenaries, members of pagan Germanic tribes, which included the Jutes from present-day Denmark. Significantly, the might of the Angles and the Saxons was also called upon. It would be a fateful decision. At first, the new arrivals achieved the desired effect. They fought hard for their British employers, but in the year 455, they turned against the Britons and began their own campaign of conquest. With the aid of reinforcements from Europe, they pushed the native population back. Only in the early 6th century was their advance halted. The British leader who achieved this would become the inspiration for a Dark Age legend, King Arthur. The famous stories of King Arthur and his Knights of the Round Table are known the world over. They are fictional, romantic tales created in the Middle Ages. But there is little doubt that a real King Arthur did lead a British army of resistance. He is mentioned in 3 first millennium chronicles. The 9th century writer Nennius describes how Arthur led an army to 11 great victories. Then, in a final confrontation at Mount Badon, his cavalry slaughtered 900 Saxon warriors in a single charge. This was the greatest moment of Arthur's career. But we may never know the full story of this most mysterious of men.
There are very few documentary sources that refer to him, and those that do are very late. They're written down centuries after the supposed King Arthur really existed. So I think we have to take his existence with a pinch of salt. However, the documentary sources and the archaeological sources do suggest that the Britons did put up a moderately successful fight against the Anglo-Saxons in the 5th century. And it may be that there were some British war leaders who led armies against the Anglo-Saxons, somebody like King Arthur, but whether there was ever a real King Arthur or not is a matter for dispute.
We know that he was a considerable personality of his time, that he had quite a considerable standing army, that he used to great effect against the somewhat sort of, I suppose you could call him scattered, Anglo-Saxon incursions. And he obviously was a charismatic leader. But having said that, I mean, so much more is accretion. And the archaeology, I mean, the sites that are associated with him are very sort of ephemerally associated with him. So one knows he was there, one knows he was a charismatic leader. One knows at Mount Badon he had an extraordinary victory, which then led to a period of relative peace between the Anglo-Saxon incomers and the Celts themselves. So he was quite something quite special.
According to the chronicler Nennius, King Arthur died in battle in 537 AD. And it is written that the following decades were a time of peace. But in 571, the Angles and Saxons attacked again. By the end of the 6th century, the Germanic tribes were all but victorious. The Britons were now confined to the western fringes of their old lands, and the invaders began to establish independent kingdoms. The Jutes took what is now the county of Kent. The Saxons settled in Essex, Sussex, and Wessex, while the Angles inhabited Mercia, Northumbria, and the lowlands of East Anglia. Here, in the early 7th century, King Raedwald ruled the land. We know that Raedwald died around 625 AD. It is also widely accepted that the East Anglians created an elaborate memorial to him. 13 centuries later, this became one of the greatest archaeological finds ever, the Sutton Hoo burial ship.
This place is the burial site of kings. Behind me is the great burial ship, which is attributed to King Radwald, who died in 624 AD. The Anglo-Saxon Scandinavian connection was, of course, that they had a great belief in ships and as nation of sea people. And so it's not surprising that a man who created such wealth and status within his own lifetime would be rewarded with a burial in a great ship.
It was in 1939, on the Suffolk estate of Sutton Hoo, that British archaeologists unearthed the site of a ship that was never intended to put to sea. Buried under 25 feet of sand, they found the remains of a vessel almost 90 feet in length. The ship's timber had rotted away, but the impression it had left revealed that it was once a mastless rowing boat. Somehow, it had been pulled overland from the nearby River Deben and buried in an enormous grave.
A lot of people come here imagining that they're going to see a ship. But in actual fact, what was found here were ship rivets that survived very well, of course, because they're base metal. And the ship mould, rather like a sandcastle, the mould of a ship was unfurled. Even the gunwales of the ship, you could see the soles where the oars would have actually been placed on either side.
The burial ship was a remarkable find in itself, but its remains were only part of the story. The East Anglians had also placed a burial chamber above the centre of the vessel. It was here that the excavators discovered a dazzling collection of treasure. Dozens of artifacts hidden from view for 1,300 years. These ancient items confirmed the Sutton Hoo ship as one of the richest archaeological finds of the 20th century.
This king had great items of kingship. He had a royal scepter, a royal standard. There were items of great beauty within the burial chamber. Textiles, carpets, gold, silver. There were over 4,000 garnets set in precious metals. And we're told by the experts that they must have been cut by children because they were so minute that adults' hands would have been too big.
It was the extraordinary craftsmanship, the design element that goes into the making of things like the shoulder clasps, the purse lid, striking figural scenes which had never been seen before on any Anglo-Saxon object and which took people totally by surprise. And it changed people's perception to a certain extent of what Anglo-Saxon kingship was all about. It gave a new perspective into a civilization, if you like, of an early Anglo-Saxon kingdom.
Of all the artifacts discovered at Sutton Hoo, the most important may be amongst the most humble in appearance. These silver spoons are inscribed in Greek. The East Anglians obviously engaged in international trade. But it is the words themselves that are more revealing. Saulos and Paulos, Greek for Saul and Paul. These are Christian artifacts buried by a people of pagan origin. The Sutton Hoo spoons provide a fine example of archaeology backing up the evidence of written history. Chronicles describe the speed at which the English peoples adopted Christianity. In 597, Augustine was sent from Rome to become the first Archbishop of Canterbury. Within weeks, he had persuaded the King of Kent to convert to the new religion. The faith soon spread, this time to East Anglia, where King Radwald was baptized before his death. We know this from the writings of a famous Christian figure of the Dark Ages, the Venerable Bede. Bede was born in the kingdom of Northumbria around 673 AD. and he spent his entire life in this windswept northern region. At the age of just 7, he was sent to train as a monk at the Jarrow Monastery, where he remained until his death in 735. There, he found time to produce an enormous number of scholarly works. He wrote some 40 books, many based on classical subjects such as rhetoric and grammar. But of all Bede's works, the most significant was his Ecclesiastical History. It was admired not only for its eloquence and reasoning, but also because parts of his Latin text were incorporated into the first great work of English prose, the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle. The Chronicle consists of 4 major manuscripts that provide a year-by-year history of England from the time of Christ. Their compilation was begun in the 9th century, and annual entries continued to be added until the middle of the 12th century. It is this later period that is especially valuable for the historian.
The Anglo-Saxon Chronicle is very important. It has informed a lot of our understanding. But archaeologists are aware, and I think historians too are aware, that the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle is not an entirely consistent document. Here, there are several versions that were written, and there are discrepancies in different versions. So you have to read it with care and understanding, but it really does provide a very useful background.
Although they do purport to tell us about what happened in the early Anglo-Saxon period, the period of Anglo-Saxon paganism, they don't really have very much secure information. They only come into their own as we get into the 8th and 9th and 10th centuries, and then they begin to tell us about current events and things the compilers actually knew about. And at that point, they do become an extremely important source for Anglo-Saxon political and religious history.
The creation of the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle may have been encouraged by the 9th century King of Wessex, Alfred the Great. Alfred was known as a great patron of culture, and the Chronicle becomes more detailed from Alfred's time onwards. But its more limited account of earlier centuries is also intriguing. Typically, the Chronicle describes obscure tribal kings and battles between the kingdoms forming at the time. But for the years 537 and 539, its entries refer only to the darkening of the sun and night stretching into day. Some modern historians believe that this is literary evidence for the so-called 535 cataclysm, a natural disaster that contributed to the birth of the Dark Ages, not just in England, but all over the world.
There is a good deal of evidence now from dendrochronological work, looking at tree rings, that at that time some severe environmental event happened which caused plant life to suffer considerably for 2 or 3 years. And the best hypothesis is that some huge volcano went off, popped, and put lots of dust into the atmosphere, which blocked out the sun.
Within the archaeology itself, there is very little to suggest that there is any disruption in everyday life. And it has to be said, I think, that generally speaking, until the catastrophe theory, one tended to think in terms of eclipse. And if you think in terms of a total eclipse, this is actually quite, has always been a very powerful element in people's lives. We know that something is going on globally. There's evidence in the ice flows, and there is a sense of disruption in other areas. But in Anglo-Saxon England, or you know, early Anglo-Saxon English, I think it's very difficult to find it.
The Anglo-Saxons had already begun their Dark Ages, if you'd like. They'd already invaded Anglo-Saxon England. They had established kingdoms in Kent and Wessex and on the Isle of Wight. And as far as the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle goes, all the events happening in Anglo-Saxon England, 535 doesn't seem to have been particularly significant, nor do the decades immediately following. So in terms of the impact on Anglo-Saxon England, I think there wasn't very much.
What really did happen in 535 is now the subject of intense academic study. Sadly, the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle fails to follow up its references to the catastrophe affecting England at the time. Its entries for the following period are concerned mainly with the spread of Christianity throughout Anglo-Saxon England. Great men of faith such as St. Columba, St. Augustine, and the Venerable Bede are all mentioned. So too is St. Cuthbert, a man forever associated with an island off the rugged coast of Northumbria, Lindisfarne, the Holy Island. The Christian status of Lindisfarne has been established for almost 1400 years. In AD 635, a monastery was built here. This was just one center of a flourishing local Christian community. The Venerable Bede lived in Northumbria, and in 685 AD, his fellow Christian, St. Cuthbert, was appointed bishop of the Northumbrian city of Hexham. But it is the island of Lindisfarne that is most associated with St. Cuthbert. He spent many years here, living as a hermit in a tiny stone cell. In fact, he was able to transfer his ministerial position to Lindisfarne from Hexham. And his faithful life came to an end on the island in May 687. In his honor, his successor, Eadfrith, produced a new copy of the Books of the Gospels. The volume that he created remains one of the greatest cultural achievements of the Dark Ages, the Lindisfarne Gospels. These sacred pages reveal the admiration that was felt for Cuthbert at the turn of the 8th century. They represent one of the finest ever examples of the Latin Gospel text known as the Vulgate. Eadfrith's masterpiece is written on 259 sheets of vellum, the majority inscribed in plain, double-columned text. But each individual gospel is also introduced by three pages which appeal more to the senses than the mind. Firstly, there is an image of each gospel's original author. Here we can see a contemplative St. John in the process of writing. The other three evangelists are also shown writing their timeless words. But Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are also represented by an abstract design page, an intricate pattern known as a carpet. For many, it is the richly colored details of these pages that are the greatest achievement of the Lindisfarne Gospels. A similar level of artistic skill can also be seen in the initial pages that announce the beginning of the biblical text. Taken together, these illuminated pages can be seen as some of the finest works of art created anywhere on earth at the time.
The Lindisfarne Gospels are an amazing artistic achievement. They were the product of one of the monastic scriptoria of the north, and they provide us with an example of some of the exquisite craftsmanship and workmanship, as well as the education available to monks in northern Anglo-Saxon England. They're also very interesting because they show a number of different artistic influences. They show Irish influence, they show insular Anglo-Saxon influence, a little bit of Pictish influence, as well as influences from the continent, from the Roman world. So they show that the Anglo-Saxon monks who constructed this wonderful manuscript were in touch with a much wider world, that Anglo-Saxon England wasn't just a small isolated pocket, but was part of a big ecclesiastical world.
The Lindisfarne Gospels are admired mostly as works of art, but their pages are also of great literary value. In the 10th century, a follower of the cult of Cuthbert decided to translate its Latin text into the everyday language of the time. His name was Aldred, and his translation was written between the lines of the Lindisfarne text. The result may have compromised the beauty of the original pages, but Aldred's achievement was substantial. His words represent a milestone in the establishment of Old English, the Anglo-Saxon language that would evolve into the modern English of today. A common language is an important component of national identity, In the 8th century, the English identity was still forming. The land remained divided into separate kingdoms, whose boundaries were always being fought over. In the later part of the century, it was the Kingdom of Mercia that grew most powerful. This was the time of King Offa. Late in his reign, he ordered that a great defensive fortification be built to protect the western border of Mercia. The result was Offa's Dyke.
As far as we know, as the name implies, it was built by King Offa of the ancient Anglo-Saxon kingdom of Mercia. Mercia was one of a number of Anglo-Saxon kingdoms that had emerged in Britain after the end of the Roman period here. And by the 8th century, when Offa's Dyke was built, Mercia was really the most important of those kingdoms. So in that sense, that does give us a context to understand Offa's Dyke. Offa is the most powerful monarch of his day. We know, for example, that he's building contacts with not only other Anglo-Saxon kings, but also with people in Europe, principally with Charlemagne, who's developing his sort of Frankish empire at the same time. So Offa is a king on the make, looking to not only protect his realm, but I think demonstrate his own power. And I think when we begin to try and understand Offa's Dyke, that's really what some of what it's about.
The construction of this massive earthwork was one of the more enduring achievements of the English Dark Age. Somehow, the Mercian king organised a workforce of thousands to create a physical boundary between Mercia and Wales. When completed, it ran for 176 miles, from Prestatyn in the north to Chepstow in the south. In places, natural obstacles such as rivers or mountains already provided effective defence, so these were incorporated into the structure. In total, around 80 miles of earthworks were constructed, a 20-foot wall of earth protected by a ditch some 60 feet wide. Sections of the dike survive to this day, and Offa's Dyke continues to mark the approximate border between England and Wales. 1,200 years ago, the creation of this physical boundary helped to define the western geographical limit of the nation that would become England.
In terms of how it functioned as a barrier, and indeed why it was built as a barrier, it's pretty obvious to argue that, you know, Offa was trying to keep out the people who live in what is now Wales. But I think you've also got a sense that we're up here in quite a remote area. There's no evidence that Offa's Dyke was ever patrolled or fortified in the same way as, for example, the earlier Roman Hadrian's Wall was. And in fact, if you wanted to cross the dyke, you probably could have done so. I think it's really probably about Offa quite literally, drawing a line in the landscape, making it a political statement and really warning people that, you know, if you cross this earthwork, well, you've got a really well-organized political and military system on the other side of this earthwork, and you're probably going to end up paying for that.
Offa's Dyke was built to protect the old English kingdom of Mercia against raids from the west. But around the time it was completed, the evolving English nation was about to face a far greater threat from the north. In the year 793, in the Kingdom of Northumbria, unwelcome visitors arrived by sea. The Anglo-Saxon Chronicle describes them as heathen men who attacked and destroyed the great church at Lindisfarne. Monks and priests were murdered. The church's possessions were looted. The Vikings had arrived. It was a terrible event, as the English scholar Alwyn confirmed in writing. Never before has such terror appeared in Britain as we have now suffered from a pagan race. It was not an exaggeration. The Vikings were pagans from the Scandinavian lands of Denmark, Sweden, and Norway. In the early centuries of the Christian era, it appears that they lived in small farming communities in their northern homeland. But our knowledge of their early existence is limited.
Archaeology tells us a great deal about the social evolution of the Vikings, about the creation of kingdoms in Scandinavia, and about the kind of development of society and culture that actually led to the Viking expansion. We've got good evidence of burials and development of kingship at Old Uppsala, for example. We've got a number of excavations of settlements and of fortresses in Scandinavia. And there are also signs of important trading settlements being set up at Helio, for example, which show Viking contacts with the wider world in terms of trade prior to their sort of explosion onto the international scene in 800.
Like the Anglo-Saxons, I think, they were a settled society. They had quite a number of royal sites. They had trading towns. They were very similar in many ways to what we see amongst the Anglo-Saxon settlements as they evolved. They were, of course, seafarers. They developed their seafaring, and it was ultimately that which led them, I suppose, to look at England as a potential area of expansion.
I think part of the whole definition of Vikings is the fact that these people went on long adventures and journeys, and they raided and then traded, and they came back with slaves and did all sorts of nasty things to people during it. And I think they weren't really Vikings until they did that. By definition, that's what being a Viking is.
Details of early Viking life are sketchy, but from the 9th century onwards, they began to make a great impression on the English nation. The attack on Lindisfarne was just the beginning of an age which saw the Vikings journey thousands of miles from their homeland. They were masters of sea travel, and their warships were built to a design that proved unrivaled for mobility and speed. Their greatest achievement may have been the creation of this historic ship of war, the longship. The Viking longship became one of the most feared sights for the people of Dark Age Europe. It was a fast ship, built in three different sizes, all of them narrow in the beam. The largest were 150 feet in length and 20 feet wide. Power was generated by a combination of square sail and muscle. Smaller longships carried 40 rowers or less. The largest carried over 60, with 120 warriors making up the complement of crew. The most distinctive feature of the longship's design was that it was clinker-built. The hull was made up of overlapping planks, riveted together and secured against the water, or caulked with tarred rope. The unusually high bow and stern were constructed from a single piece of timber, as was the keel. It was on ships like this that the Viking warriors set out on their missions of conquest.
I think one of the key features of the Viking longships is the fact that they developed a very deep keel. They were clinker-built, overlapping planks like the earlier ships on both sides of the North Sea. But gradually, the Vikings developed a hull that was very flexible, was strengthened internally by an extra strake called Meggenhufer, and they also developed deep keels which bit into the surface of the water, which enabled their sailing skills to develop to quite a considerable extent.
The longships were particularly effective vessels because they could be both rowed and they could sail, and they could cope with coastal waters just going round the coast. They could go up rivers. They were relatively light. I mean, a bit of hard work, but you could haul them up the rivers and a bit across land if necessary. And they could go across deep oceans.
They developed transports. They could carry goods. They could carry cattle. They developed seafaring far beyond anything that certainly the Anglo-Saxons did.
We do not know for sure why the Vikings made the decision to break out of their homeland, but the consequences of that decision are well documented. From the year 835 onwards, the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle reports wave after wave of summer raids by the warriors of the north. It was a fearful time for the inhabitants of England. The Viking reputation for rape, plunder, and slaughter became well established.
They've always been described as rapists, pillagers, raiders. They come in their long boats. They swarm up the beaches and destroy communities. And so one tends to forget that archaeology tells us that in fact they were in fact traders. They did establish trading towns. I mean, Jorvik is one of them, Dublin is the other one. And they did establish themselves within England as an expansionist but settled community in the end.
Things soon grew worse for the English. In 851, a party of raiders remained in England over the winter instead of returning home on their famous longships. Soon, the Vikings began to settle on English soil. In 865, they established themselves in East Anglia. The following year, they headed north and captured the city of York. Soon, a huge swathe of English territory was under Viking control. This was the land of the Danelaw.
The Danelaw is a term used to describe the area controlled by the Danes in England, where their law prevailed rather than the English law, the Anglo-Saxon law. And part of the reason why the Danelaw was established was to make sure that the English living within the Danelaw were properly protected and had a reasonable weregild, that is, they had a reasonable man price on their heads, so that they would receive a fair treatment in case of any criminal trial.
The later years of the 9th century saw the Vikings consolidate their position in settlements like Jorvik, their name for the city of York. By the beginning of the 870s, just one English kingdom remained free of their dominance. This was the Kingdom of Wessex, led by King Alfred, the man who finally turned the tide of the Viking advance. In the year 876, Alfred led his men to a great victory over a Viking army at the Battle of Edington. The subsequent peace gave him the opportunity to encourage a new age of scholarship in the lands of Wessex. Alfred is the only English king to have become known as the Great. But his successor's achievements were hardly less impressive. Following Alfred's death in 899, the House of Wessex continued to lead resistance to the Vikings. Under Edward the Elder, Athelstan, and Edred, the lands of England were reconquered. This can be seen as the time when the English nation was beginning to define itself. These Wessex rulers are now recognized as the first kings of all England. By the year 954, the English army of King Edred stood on the point of ending a century of Viking domination. That year, in a fierce battle at the city of York, the Viking leader, Eric Bloodaxe, was defeated. The settlement of Jorvik that Eric had ruled was now in English hands. But we can still appreciate the kind of existence that the Vikings led when they lived there. In 1976, a major archaeological excavation began on the site of an old factory in the present-day district of Coppergate. The intention was to find physical evidence of a Viking community that had flourished over 1,000 years before. Soon, the secrets of the past revealed themselves. There were cellars and the remains of buildings. There were also a huge number of small artifacts preserved in the peaty mud of the area. The project leaders recognized that there was enough material to create an authentic reconstruction of Viking York. The result was the Jorvik Viking Centre. Opened in 1984 on the site of the excavation, the Jorvik Centre is now a popular tourist attraction. Here, visitors can appreciate the sights, the sounds, even the smells of the Viking Age. The reconstruction is set in the year 948, 6 years before the city was taken back by the English. The faces of these individuals are also the result of painstaking efforts. All of them are based on real skulls unearthed at the excavation site. Jorvik was a trading centre, as we can see in the reconstruction of the dockside. But we can be certain that vessels like this did journey upriver from the North Sea. They journeyed all round the British Isles. They travelled south as far as Spain and into the Mediterranean. In northern France, a group of Viking voyagers founded a colony which became the Duchy of Normandy. In the 9th century, they arrived at the island of Iceland. The 10th century saw Viking settlements established in Greenland. Not long afterwards, Viking seamen arrived on the shores of the North American continent, 500 years before the famous voyage of Columbus. The voyages of discovery made by Viking sailors can be seen as their greatest achievement. But it's unlikely that they were appreciated by 10th century Englishmen. In the last decades of the 10th century, the raiding of England began with greater zeal than ever. To begin with, they demanded huge sums of annual tribute money, the so-called Danegeld. In 1012, the English were forced to hand over £48,000 weight of silver, but the huge payments failed to stifle Viking territorial ambition. By 1016 AD, the Danish King Canute sat on the throne of all England. Soon, he was leader of an empire that also included Norway. But the age of Canute marked the peak of the Viking Age. Christianity was already changing the way of life in the north. Canute's successors were unable to hold on to his territories. In 1042, the accession of Edward the Confessor restored Anglo-Saxon rule in England. There would be just one more Viking attack on England, the invasion of Harald Hardrada in the year 1066. Following this Norwegian leader's defeat at the Battle of Stamford Bridge, the Vikings never again came to English shores. Soon, their unique way of life had disappeared forever.
I think there are a number of factors that ended the Viking way of life. I think first you might consider that many of those who started out as pirates or raiders or looters eventually settled down and their families adopted the way of life of the groups they had settled amongst, like the Danes in Anglo-Saxon England, for example. I think another important factor was the conversion of the Vikings to Christianity. And part of adopting Christianity meant you adopted the culture and the outlook of the Western world. So you changed your viewpoint and you started to cherish those things, such as monasteries and churches, which previously the Vikings had pinpointed as their targets for looting.
Well, many aspects of the Viking way of life continued. For example, bad water and irregular food supplies, and quite a lot of the clothing and the way people dressed is very similar. And what we have in York particularly is a period which we call Anglo-Scandinavian, because it's really very much a fusion of influences from Scandinavia and things much more that were here in Britain before the Vikings got here. But I suppose administratively the thing that clobbered Vikings was when William the Conqueror came and settled and took dominion.
1066 can be seen as marking the end of the English Dark Age. It was not only the Vikings who suffered a decisive defeat in the course of that memorable year. Just 3 weeks after the Battle of Stamford Bridge, the English King Harold was slain at the Battle of Hastings. The victorious William of Normandy now took the English throne. In the course of his strong reign, a different kind of England began to be formed.
1066 is the big date that everybody knows that marks the conquest of Anglo-Saxon England by the Normans. And immediately afterwards, England did change in a number of significant ways. For a start, there were Norman overlords speaking a new language, which caused a change in the language that the Anglo-Saxons were speaking. For a second, there were some new building programs, castles appeared, and new systems of law were introduced. But for many of the Anglo-Saxons, particularly the villeins and the people who worked the land, I think initially they wouldn't have noticed any major changes. And in fact, Anglo-Saxon culture was already very European culture before the Normans invaded. So in many ways, the changes weren't as dramatic and as significant as perhaps the idea of a conquest might imply.
In England, as elsewhere in Europe, the Dark Age can be a difficult period of history to appreciate. Its achievements were far fewer than those of the Classical Age that preceded it. But for the English people in particular, it is a time that continues to exert a fascination. The Dark Age saw the birth of the unified England that still exists over 1,000 years later. The story of how it happened can be obscure and mysterious. Perhaps it is this sense of mystery that we can most appreciate today.